chance of winning football games if we do that. So we have to get off the field and stop them, and especially as the field starts to condense, if they are moving the football.
One area I'm sure you weren't happy with, it seemed like there were several penalties unsportsmanlike. I wanted to say at least four off the top of my head. What was happening there with the team?
Well, I think there's two unsportsmanlikes that, you know, truly are ones that are the ones that really irritate a coach. I mean, the ones that really irritate a coach is when it's either you get pushed and you push back and you're the second guy, which is totally, to me, lack of preparation, because you should prepare yourself for all those situations, or hits after the play is dead. And I thought we had two or three total of those. Some of the ones out of bounds, those are judgment calls by an official. And, you know, sometimes you'd be on the player pretty hard if he let up and the guy stayed in bounds for 7 extra yards. But I thought the three that were hits out of bounds, probably, you know, maybe they're called, maybe they're not called. But I think also frustration plays in it. And I think we were on defensive frustrated football team the other night, unfortunately. And I think that has a little bit to do with lack of mental preparation. Because if you're mentally prepared, those plays wouldn't happen. That's not been us for the, I don't know how many games I've been here now, but even 4-7, 6-3, whatever we are, we haven't been a highly penalized team in the first 18, 19 games that I've coached here. So I was extremely disappointed in that part of it. And the players have heard it and know that exactly what the wrath of Walsh might be able to be.
How nice is it 9 games in to still be playing for something? Because this wasn't the case last year. I mean, you got 2 games and your season's still on the line. I mean, just overall, how enjoyable is it at this time?
Well, we're definitely excited about it. And I think that hopefully our players will be excited. I think it's important. I think our players are kind of relieved with the performance maybe that we had the other night. And we have 2 big football games against a team that played very well against us last year here. And now we have the opportunity to go there and play. And I think University of South Dakota, they beat a Big Ten school. I mean, and they woulda, coulda, shoulda beat Northern Iowa, who's an excellent FCS school. And they've played very well against all other opponents. And Southern Utah kind of pulled away from them in the second half. But we're playing against a very talented football team and maybe the most talented offense that we played with Dante Warren, a quarterback. He's an outstanding football player that we're going to have to not allow him to run the football effectively against us. I can tell you that much.
Yeah, just talk about real quick. I mean, playing on the road, it's been a while, but you guys certainly know it better than anybody else. Will that help you in this game, if anything? And what are the travel arrangements? And just so we kind of know where you guys are at this week.
Well, thanks to Allison Cohen. My motto this week is we're traveling the best way that you can possibly travel in college football, so we better play our best football game. That's going to be my motto to our team. So, you know, we're going the right way. We're leaving Friday, and we're going straight into Sioux Falls, South Dakota, which is about 30 miles from the stadium. We'll play the football game Saturday afternoon. We'll be back in our own beds by 11:30 or 12 that night, and hopefully with a W, and hopefully having played our best football game to date.
And what kind of difference does that make when it's not like, you know, planes, trains, and automobiles when you get to do this?
I guess we're going to find out. That's what I would say right now. You know, I've coached in positions before where you've had to do it a lot of different ways. There's a lot of different ways to say that you're right or wrong on them. We've taken tough trips to McNeese State and Old Dominion and came away with wins against, I think, 2 of the better opponents that we played this year. And, you know, we've gone to some other places maybe and not won when we've been on the road going the tough way too. So how much it plays into it, I think a lot of it has to do with what you do Monday through Thursday to prepare yourself to play on Saturday, regardless of how you travel or how you get to a place. We got to do a great job at practice the rest of this week, and when we get on that airplane, we have to have the confidence that we can win regardless of what's going to be inside that stadium. I know what, we're going to be there. And that's good enough for me. If we play our best, I'll be extremely excited with what the outcome's going to be.
Yeah. My final question, again, you talked about South Dakota. If you can elaborate on, you know, they're 4-5, but that's probably misleading. They have beaten Minnesota, as we know. What kind of team are you guys going to run up against here this weekend?
Well, they lost to Central Florida, who looks like they're going to be a bowl team in the FCS division. They beat the University of Minnesota, who's a Big Ten school. I mean, I think that that's regardless of what Minnesota's record is, I think that's still a great, great win for the University of South Dakota. They played Northern Iowa tough. They played Davis tough and lost. The first half against Southern Utah was an excellent football game. The Southern Utah kind of pulled away in the second half at Southern Utah. So we're playing a football team that could easily be just like we are. They could easily be 6-3. And I think our conference, I've said all along, if you go 1-5, we're all about as good as each other. And that's why I credit Southern Utah, because they've been good enough each week to win and beat people in our conference. And that's what you have to do to win a championship. In our case, we're playing for a lot. And number one, we're playing because we have the opportunity to play another football game. Number two, we have the opportunity for some postseason play. And what it is an opportunity, and you need to take advantage of the opportunities that you have.
A lot of attention has been focused on Andre and his injury, but your quarterback, Smith, has played really well over the last 2 weeks or so. Can I get a reaction to
what? Well, I've said all along, all three quarterbacks. We have three. You know, Doug Shumway, I mean, I don't know if we beat Montana if Doug Shumway doesn't play well. He steps in when Tony did get injured and played extremely well when Andre was down. And then I think Tony's had the opportunity, because Andre's down, to do some good things. And if you watch us play, we're probably a little bit different on how we play, depending on who's playing. But really, all three of them, it still starts with the triple option. Even though Tony's throw numbers have been pretty good, a lot of that is because the opponents know they still need to defend the triple option. And that's going to be the basis of who we are, regardless of who plays quarterback this week. But the most important thing is trying to be efficient. And one thing Tony, I think, has done a really good job of is showing the maturity that he has and the experience he has by how he's managed the games in the last 2 weeks. He's managed the games very well, and the outcome is he's protected the football and done some things that I think have allowed us to give us opportunities to score some points.
You said your team has to kind of change depending on who the quarterback is. How do you think they handle that?
Well, I mean, we practice everything we do, but the change is the triple option, like I said, is going to be the basis of who we are. So that's not going to change. You know, how we throw it with Andre or how we run it if Andre's in the game might be a little bit different, and same with Doug, if Doug's in the game. Tony does other things that we think are extremely beneficial to who we are and what we want to be as we play. And so each guy understands who they are and how they fit, and Coach Cook does a good job of making sure that he knows if this guy's a quarterback, then this is who we'll be. If this guy's a quarterback, this is who we'll be. And I think that that's the way we'll continue to approach it. We think we have three versatile quarterbacks that I think can help us win a football game, all three of them.
And you talked about this week how your team came out with not quite a sense of urgency in the first half, then picked it up in the second half. How do you think your team, how will you instill that sense of urgency this week, or is just the situation bring that about?
Well, I think that, well, it's the same situation. We couldn't afford to lose last week either. So, I mean, the bottom line thing is that, you know, I think sometimes as a coach you can be confident, you can tell your players the truth, I told them before, I think we should beat St. Francis. I mean, I'm up front with them. And I think sometimes because the head coach stands up there and says those things, sometimes the players think, okay, we're going to beat St. Francis. Well, the reality of the situation is you still have to play and play well in order to win a football game. I think this week, if the win over University of Minnesota and the way they played against University of Northern Iowa and the way they played last week, they scored their first four possessions last week against a Big Sky school 24-0 in the second quarter. Game was over. So if that doesn't get their attention, then I don't know what else will. But obviously the other part of it is, you know, we can't look ahead. And you mentioned the sense of urgency, and so did I. The sense of urgency to play that game is the most important thing. Not the sense of urgency when the game's over, that we won that game or whatever happened in the game. We need to have it now at practice, a sense of urgency in how we prepare and making sure that we're mentally sharp when we get on the field Saturday at 4 o'clock.
Coach, I have one question for you. Last Saturday with the 50th reunion of the 1960 football team, some of the survivors went into the locker room before the game. Can you tell me, share with us what some of the things they said and what some of the players might have said to them?
Well, obviously that was an emotional time for all of us. I mean, I really think that when you look at who we are at Cal Poly football and where we've been over the last 50 years, and I know we've played football longer than that, I think that that team does demonstrate exactly the strength you want out of each and every young person that plays football here. And I think that those guys coming back was pretty emotional, shake their hand, bringing them into the locker room and having the players have an eyeball contact with the pass rather than reading about a plane crash. They saw these men, and these men are men. These are the guys, I really call them giants of the Cal Poly football program, because they survived something and they've turned their lives into successes despite the tragedy that happened in 1960. So extremely emotional. I think there was a lot of smiles on those guys' faces, which was good to see, because coming back here is a difficult time for those guys. It brings back a lot of bad memories, and I think seeing young people achieve and have the ability to achieve, I think put a smile on those guys' face that, you know, that this is still college football. It's no different than it was 50 years ago. So really appreciate all of them that came back, and hope they enjoyed the afternoon.